Ok, dovremmo finalmente esserci. Ok, first point, okay, I modified the last code. I think it's the number 5.18 and already put the new version on our page. Ho il microfono acceso, sì. Forse sì, spero. Ah, ok, perfetto.
Sì, la sentiamo.
Anyway, today we will discuss a couple of other little programs, so we can even look wherever was the problem of the previous version. Let me start one note here. Before doing that, let me discuss shortly facendo qualcosa di bello. Ok, dai. Let me discuss shortly how to deal with not homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions. So we discussed this when solving the differential equation directly. Let me just summarize which is the problem. So the problem is, suppose that we have something like, this is very, very thick, something like minus derivative respect to x of k of x du over dx equal to f of x in a certain range 0 L, but this time the Dirichlet conditions, instead of putting u of 0 equal to 0, we put u 0 equal to alpha and u of L equal to beta. And if you recall, there is a simple technique for dealing with this not homogeneous or homogeneous boundary conditions. And the technique is to introduce a function. Let's call this function g of x. And this function g of x satisfies the boundary conditions. So essentially we have g of 0 is equal to alpha and g of L is equal to beta. But this function can be a very simple function, for instance, a linear function that if, for instance, k is equal to 1, k is this object here, then it is annihilated by the differential operator, and so it provides a very simple solution because we just solve the problem with homogeneous boundary conditions, and after we add to the solution with homogeneous boundary conditions, the function g of x, because if a function g of x is annihilated by the differential operator, it does not change, so to say, the left-hand side of the equation, but it provides the correct boundary conditions. So let's see how to implement a similar idea in our new way of solving this type of equations by using the weak version of the problem. So the idea is that, of course, we can still rewrite this strong version as a weak version. So our weak version, recall we introduced a functional A. The functional A is that bilinear that essentially is obtained from the left-hand side of the equation. And you recall that this strong version of the problem can be reformulated as, let's say, A of U and V, V equal to F V for all, and this has to be satisfied for all V belonging to a space big V. So we are looking for a function U that satisfies this equation for whatever function V inside our space big V. Now, which is the difference? This is how we wrote our problem in the case of homogeneous boundary conditions. And in that case, if the conditions on the solution were homogeneous, then also U was belonging to this same space. So this space here, this space V, can be, for instance, a space of the form, let's say, L square restricted 0L, meaning that our test function is a function which is continuous up to the second derivative in the interval 0L, and this D tells us that actually the test function satisfies the homogeneous boundary conditions. So if a problem is a problem of homogeneous boundary conditions, then also U belongs to this same space. But now instead we know that U has to satisfy this not homogeneous boundary conditions. So what we can claim is that we are looking for a solution U, but this solution U, so to say, can be written as a sum, let's say, of G plus omega, where G is our function that I wrote here that satisfies the two boundary conditions, and it is omega that instead belongs to the space V. Because at that point, our omega will satisfy homogeneous boundary conditions, and therefore omega belongs to V. So how can we reformulate our problem in such a case? So the solution is U, okay? So U is the quantity that we want to find, and U has to satisfy these two not homogeneous boundary conditions. And we have introduced an auxiliary function G, which satisfies the two boundary conditions. And now what we do is to shift, we say that U is the sum of that function G that I have not yet defined completely. I just said that G has to satisfy the two boundary conditions, plus an omega, and this omega now can satisfy the homogeneous boundary conditions, and so concerning omega, we are back to the original problem that we discussed the lessons, the previous lessons. So essentially, the problem can be formulated in the following way. Since you recall that A is bilinear, so is linear in both arguments, so instead of writing, let's say, A of G plus omega, G plus omega, you recall, is U, comma V, I can write A of G, comma V, plus A of omega, comma V. So this was, of course, A of U and V. Okay. So here I've used the fact that this operator A is linear, also in the first argument, And therefore, it is clear that I can essentially rewrite my problem in a more standard way. I can, in particular, write, you see, this A of U and V is this object here. I use the linearity, and this we know that has to be equal to F, V. So we can rewrite our problem in another form. If we take this last two terms, we can write as A of, sorry, this is V, not F, sorry. This one is V, okay. This one is V. Okay. So we can rewrite our problem as A of omega V equal to F V minus A of G V. And now we know that V belongs, as before, V belongs to our space big V. And also omega, the solution, will belong to the same space. So we are back, so to say, to the same problem that we discussed in the previous lessons. The only difference is that we have modified the right-hand side of the solution. In a sense, it is similar as if we have modified the function f that we had on the right-hand side. So notice this seems a little trick, but it's quite a standard thing. It's possible to transfer the not homogeneity of the boundary conditions into the not homogeneity of the equation itself. So the equation itself containing an f, which was breaking the homogeneity of the equation, and we transfer there the not homogeneous boundary conditions. So at this point, it is clear that we are able to solve this problem because we just need to take into account that the right-hand side is not just F, but is F minus this other quantity. Okay. So in practical terms, what do we do? Practical terms. So you recall that our technique of finite elements was based. Okay, first of all, we rewrite our equation in this weak form, what we have done now. We have rewritten our equation in a weak form, and moreover, it is homogeneous. So it is just exactly what we did the previous times. After, there is this general idea of Galerkin that tells us that there is a completely safe way to restrict from the big space V to some much smaller space Sn, some simple function, it's a finite number of simple functions, for instance, our triangular functions that we discussed the last lessons. And the equation that we are writing is totally consistent. It's the best approximation to the solution within that subspace. And the last the last point was, of course, to choose a smart basis that was, for instance, the basis of these triangular functions that are providing us a quasi-diagonal matrix that enters our linear algebra problem. So, in concrete, what do we do if we want to solve this problem now using our triangular basis, et cetera, et cetera? So let me remind you just one thing. When we introduced our triangular base of functions, so this was 0 and L, and we built a grid. And as you recall, in this grid, we were building triangular functions, like this one, or this one. And this is, therefore, is x1, x2, and this is xn minus 1, this is xn, and this is, of course, x0. And this, therefore, is phi1, and this is phi n minus 1, okay? So you recall that we commented we don't need to introduce phi zero and phi n. Let me use another color. Phi zero would be something like this, and phi n would be something like this. Why we don't need to introduce phi zero and phi n? Well, of course, because the solution, the U that we were looking for, was satisfying the homogeneous boundary condition, was vanishing at zero and at L. Now we are exactly in the situation in which instead we want to have a solution which is not zero at zero and at L. So in concrete terms, we need this time to use also phi zero and phi n. So how do we use phi zero and phi n? Well, first of all, the idea is that we can write our g function in terms of phi zero and phi n. For instance, we can write our gn, let's say, as alpha phi zero plus beta phi n. You recall that this phi function are such that phi I x j is equal to delta I j, meaning that only one of these functions is different from zero and actually equal to one in one of the points of the grid, of the nodal points of the grid. All the other basis functions are zero in that point of the grid. Okay, so it means essentially that if I take phi zero is the only one contributing at x equal to zero, and similarly phi n is the only one contributing at xn, which is L. Okay, so this object here, this function gn that I just introduced, has the nice property that is exactly equal to alpha at zero and to beta at L, and it is instead exactly zero in all the other points of the grid. Okay, so it's not really disturbing our writing of the solution in the other points, is only touching the two extreme points. So again, in concrete terms, what do we do? So we wrote here this equation. This is the equation, the weak form of our equation. Let's now rewrite this object here using Galerkin idea in our subspace, the subspace of the linear, piecewise linear functions. So from that object, we write instead something as A of omega n f is equal to f v minus a of gn v, and this is has to be satisfied for all v belonging to s n. So let me compare the two equations here and here. So notice what we have done. We have restricted the test function to Sn. We have restricted also the solution to Sn, okay, and also this Gn, that this is sort of auxiliary function, we have also chosen to belong to Sn. And we know that restricting everything to this subspace due to that projection theorem is the best that we can do. So you see that in practical terms, the problem is very simple, and I'm going to show you an example in a numerical code. It's simple because what happens that the left-hand side of the equation, this part here, is exactly in the standard form. Nothing changes here. So what changes is only here on the right-hand side. And how much do we have to change? Well, not a lot, because The point is we are expanding also V, as you recall, exactly on the same basis of the functions phi 1, phi n minus 1, okay? So actually V is just one each of the functions of the basis, okay? So this last term here, which is the correction, what is really doing? So Gn contains phi 0 and phi n. So if I take V as belonging to the phi 1 phi n minus 1, okay, let me remind again, V is the test function. The test function belongs to Sn. Notice that this Sn is the space, is the space we discussed last time, is the space of piecewise linear functions which are vanishing at zero and at L. Okay, so the smart thing that we have done has been essentially to eliminate this not homogeneity in the boundary conditions, pushing it completely on the right hand side, inside the F. So now we have just to understand how much this last term here is changing the right hand side. So V is one of these functions, and Gn contains 0 and n. And you recall that if we choose these five functions as triangular functions, as I was showing, what happens is that I have a very limited numbers of elements of scalar products which are different from zero. Essentially, what happens is that if I take phi 1, yes, I mean, if I take here V equal to phi 1, then indeed I have some modification, because of course A of let's say Gn phi 1 sorry, there is some water. Sorry. This object here, in concrete terms, is alpha of A of phi 0, phi 1. And this, of course, is different from 0. And similarly, if I take the last element, if I take again Gn phi n minus 1, this will be equal to beta A of, and this becomes phi n minus 1, and also this is different from 0. But this phi A phi 0 phi 1 and A phi n minus 1 are exactly the same type of scalar products, if you like, that we computed last time. So are analytic, are trivial things. So all the other objects are zero. I mean, if I take A of Gn phi I with I from 2 up to n minus 2, they are all zero. There is no overlap. Okay. It's clear enough this point, because this is the only point to remind if we want to implement this technique in concrete. So the point is we shift completely the not homogeneity into the right hand side, and it is rather simple what we have to change, because we have only to modify two of the elements. Recall this FV typically becomes F phi I, okay, with I running from 1 up to n minus 1. These objects here are our FI, okay, FI are the projections of F on the basis, okay. So how many of these objects we have to modify? Only two, the first and the last. All the other are just the same. Okay. So I think at this point that we can just look in concrete how I wrote this this idea in concrete in our Python program. So let's open spider. Let's see. Oh, let me also share with you the codes. Allora, dunque. It is Google. Oops. How you do this? Okay. Google Classroom, no? Okay, one goes here. And should be under this, I guess. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Notice I substituted the example 5.18, as I told you, which is the correct version. And let me add other two. I think the 5.19, okay, and the 5.20. Dunque, here browse 19. Okay, open. And also the other one, 5.20. Okay, and these are, okay, 5.19 and 5.20, okay. Okay, post. Okay, you should have now this thing. First thing, let me just show you, there was a mistake at the end of the 5.18, so now I clear it up. How you open file? Open 5.18. Yeah, okay. So I also added a few comments here and there. And where was the mistake? So let me just remind you this little, because it's the same type of code that we are going to use in the other two examples. So this 5.18 was for an homogeneous boundary a problem with some homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions, and the k was equal to 1, I think, and f of x was equal to exponential of x, if I recall correctly. And so what you do is, first of all, here you build your piecewise functions. And okay, and after you build your matrix, the matrix essentially contains those scalar products. I mean, here is very, very simple, because k is equal to 1, and therefore if k is equal to 1, you essentially have just to integrate the x of the derivative of phi I derivative of phi j. And so you get something very simple. And so actually another important point here is that all the elements along one of the diagonals are the same, because if you integrate d phi I over the x, d phi j over the x, there is no dependence on I and j if the scalar product is different from zero on the off diagonal. They don't depend on I and j. So it's just a constant all along. So that's why I used here this little trick I just put 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and after I multiply the 1 by a number and similarly. And this is the total matrix. Where really one has to be very careful, that in fact is where I did a mistake, is with the index I. Because let's look again a moment here to these functions. So you recall that these functions, the functions that we need, they go from phi 1 to phi n minus 1. And they are explicitly defined here. I mean, here I really need a 1, because with a 1, I really start from x0 with my triangle and so on and so forth. Recall that the tricky thing concerning Python is that in the array and in the matrices, it does not count 1, 2, n, but 0, 1, n minus 1. I still have to discover, there must be a way to use in a smart way this idea, but for the moment it's just complicating my life, at least. But anyway, one has just to keep in mind what Python does. So if we have functions, and our functions, we want to call them phi 1, phi n minus 1, because essentially they correspond to functions which are centered at x1 and x minus 1, then we have to keep in mind that first index is really 1 and not 0, okay? So when we go down, for instance, we go down, where is it now? We go down here. This is one of the, there are two points where one has to be careful. In one of the points I was careful, in the other not. So this point here, what is this object? This is where I essentially project the function f on the elements of the base. And I am building a column, okay? So if I write I in range n minus 1, for Python, this means 0, 1, up to n minus 2, actually. That's it. I mean, we have to accept life. So we have to be careful. Maybe there is a smarter way after to deal. I still have to find out. But for the moment, I have done this in a not smart way, but at least apparently correct, which is the following. So what happens is that this function, fun1, is essentially the original function. It's just original function multiplied by the exponential. And after, I have to integrate to project. Okay. So as I told a second ago, this function, I really want the index to be 1 n minus 1. I don't want to change that, okay? So you have to be careful here, because the index I instead is running from 0 to n minus 2. So it means that the argument with which I am calling fun has to be increased by 1, because I don't want the index I to go from 0 to n minus 2, but from 1 to n minus 1. So I am calling the function fun1 with the index I that runs from 0 to n minus 2 plus 1. At this point, I am really calling phi1, phi2, phi n minus 1. And this I did last time, but what I forgot was also here, when you compute the solution, is exactly the same problem. So when you compute the solution, also here you have to recall that if you write I in range up to n minus 1, again here I would take from 0 to n minus 2, which is what you don't want. So you have to write fun of I plus 1. I mean, these are trivial things, but if you don't, you don't get the right solution. That's it. So now it works. Let me just show you. I also made the little plot that I was telling last time. So this is the matrix, and okay, this is the plot, and you can barely see, probably, I don't know if you can even barely see, there are two lines. One is some ugly color like orange, and the other is blue. And the orange is the exact solution, and the blue is our approximation taking 10 intervals between 0 and 1. Okay. So this is the correct version of the 518. So let's change now to the 519. The difference is small, but anyway, it may be worth discussing together. I have to open, isn't it? Open 519. Okay, so the 519, the difference is that the k is no more 1, but is 1 plus x. And instead, f is just 1. F of x is just 1. So k is 1 plus x this time. And f of x instead is 1. So what do you have to change? Which is really, you have to write in a different way your three diagonal matrix K. Because if you think a moment, let me do it here a second, maybe. Okay, doesn't matter, I can write it just a second. I was writing this thing somewhere, I don't know where. Probably here, I don't know. Anyway. Okay, sorry. Oh gosh, okay, doesn't matter. The point is, you have now to evaluate this integral, this integral between 0 and L, dx, k of x, d phi I over dx, d phi j over dx. The point is, since k depends on x, this time this object is not the same in dependence, so to say, on the values of I. It will depend on it, okay? And it's still extremely trivial to compute, can be computed analytically in a very, very simple way, but it depends on the index I. So let's see a moment how you can do, just to familiarize with Python. So is what I have done I've done here. Okay, so the matrix I wrote here. From here forth, we choose the dimension of the base by fixing n. Quindi here I've chosen n equal to 5, h is 1 over n. At that point, what I can do is to start by building objects which have a right dimension. Recall that this three diagonal matrix, you build using this little command, you build just putting together the diagonals. So this corresponds to a diagonal below the main diagonal, just one step below. This is the main diagonal, and this is above the main diagonal by one step. So you just need to write these objects, the main diagonal and the off diagonal. So the main diagonal is written here, and there's a length n minus 1. Why? Because as usual, we go from phi 1, phi 2, phi n minus 1. So the length of this object is n minus 1. The off diagonal has one element less, of course. And at that point, what you can do is you literally write down the analytical expression of that integral. This I have not done inside the code. I mean, I wrote what was obtained during the analytic calculation. It's very easy. Just keep in mind that there could be concrete situations in which maybe you are not able to provide an analytic expression for this matrix element, and then you have to write here something as a numerical integration using, for instance, that routine quad that we discussed some time ago. Okay, so this is essentially the only difference respect to the previous case, because after the function f is very trivial, it's just one, and therefore when I integrate, I don't have to do anything. I mean, I just take this fun one, because the fun above, where is going up? Sorry. Fun one is the function, the basis functions multiplied by f of x, but f of x is one. So essentially fun one and fun are just the same object. And here I am really integrating to project, integrating fun one between zero and one to project. Recall the same trick as before, this index I plus one. The rest is, I think, essentially exactly the same, so you can run it and you get this. So again, the orange is the exact solution and the blue is the approximation. So as a final example, let's see the one in which we have not homogeneous boundary conditions. So the 520. The 520. So the 520 is essentially the same problem as the 519. So the 519, there was that k of x equal to 1 plus x, and the function f was equal to 1, okay? So it's the same problem, but this time we have boundary conditions, so that at the origin it must be equal to 2, and at L must be equal to 1, okay? And L is 1, actually. So let's see exactly what I had to do. It was not much. So here I define these functions, okay. I also can define the integral of the projection of the f of x on the basis, but f of x is just one, so I just wrote one here. After, as before, I choose a certain n, which splits the interval in n subintervals. L was 1, so is 1 divided by n. Exactly as before, I proceed by filling the matrix K. You recall that the matrix K is not touched by this procedure. If we go here, I have not given a name to this page. Let me just put a name maybe to this page, if I can, but I don't recall. Here I can write. Let's call this not homogeneous, maybe inhomogeneous. How do you do this? Oh gosh. No, it's too much. Inhomogeneous. Okay, sorry. Not homogeneous. Not homogeneous. Okay, so. So the K is not really touched because we have rewritten the problem this way. The K originates from the left-hand side. So we have only to modify the column of the projections of the F, and now the first and the last need to be modified. And very important point, we solve now the problem as if it was a problem with homogeneous boundary conditions. But recall that the real solution is not what we are getting now. We have to add at the very last the function g of x, because we have subtracted g of x in order to go from not homogeneous to homogeneous. But at the very end, we have to add again g of x, okay, because we made this subtraction here, essentially. The solution is the omega that we are going to determine plus g. Okay, let's go back here. So, the f is written exactly as before. So, I did not touch anything here. It's the integral of that fun one, which is in principle the product of the elements of the base times f of x. I have only modified phi 0 and phi 3. Actually, I could be much smarter. I see it now. Because instead of writing 3, I could have written n minus 1. Okay, maybe you can improve this, because I wrote 3 because in this specific case, n is equal to 4. And therefore, recall again that f is f0, 1, 2, 3, and not f1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So this f3 is the last one, but it's the last one only because I have chosen n equal to 5. Okay. So change it, maybe substitute instead of 3, you can put n minus 2. Okay. I know that it looks very, very odd. I mean, n is equal to 5. That means that in principle we have phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, phi 4. And now phi 1, phi 4 becomes phi 0, phi 3, or better, f0, f3 inside Python, because it shifted to the left. So the last, if I have n equal to 5, the last element is actually n minus 2. Okay, the last element of the basis. So maybe change this. This morning I forgot to generalize. You can put here maybe a n minus 2 that should be better. Anyway, so you solve exactly the problem in the same way. You have just modified the f. You solve the linear algebra problem here. The linear algebra problem is the problem ax equal to f, or kx equal to f, kx equal to f. And you build your solution, but as I was mentioning, recall that after you have computed the solution, it is what you have done here, you have multiplied each of the elements of the base by the coefficient, you have to add g of x. And g of x was alpha times phi 0 plus beta times phi n. Okay, because recall, I mean, the phi are numbered in the proper way. Okay, is what I've done here, and okay, this is what you get. Oops, after I plotted it, and, it looks very much a straight line. I think there are small deviations from the straight line if you plot it more carefully, but let's see. Okay, so maybe have a look at this code and change it, modify it better, because I forgot. F0, F3, it works because I have chosen n equal to 5, but it's better if you modify it in a more general way. Okay. Any questions for this part? Because instead we can move to a different topic, which is time-dependent partial differential equations. Any questions? This is okay from home?
Yes, it's okay. Thank you.
Okay, then what I want to start please discuss with you how to solve time dependent partial differential equations. And we will start by studying the equation of diffusion. And as we did in the case of the time independent equation, we will start with the technique of Fourier. Okay. So let me add another page and let me call this page somehow. Just a second, let me call this somehow like diffusion Fourier. Okay, so which is the general idea? The general idea is very simple. We have discussed the Fourier decomposition in the case of time independent equations. Essentially, we expanded everything on a basis, the basis of the eigenfunctions of the differential operator, satisfying the same boundary conditions of our problem. And now the idea is we again expand everything on that basis, but the coefficients of the expansion will be time dependent. And of course, we will have to solve a differential equation, which is the one regulating the time dependence of the coefficients. This is the idea. Okay. So let me, so we start by discussing this equation of diffusion. Heat flow, diffusion, whatever, is the same equation. So the type of equation that we are going to discuss is something like this. So we have, oops, this is getting too large now. Yeah. Okay. So the type of equation is rho c, where rho is the density, and c, okay, can depend on the problem. If, for instance, we are studying the diffusion of heat, then this is essentially the heat capacity. And so we have rho c du over dt, t, minus k, second derivative of u respect to x square, equal to f of x and t. And we want to solve this in an interval and for times t larger than t zero. Now, as you recall, this equation is first order in time and second order in space. So we will have the two boundary conditions that we discussed many times when studying the time independent problem. And concerning the derivative respect to time, we need one initial condition. Typically, we are telling the u at a certain initial time, t0. So we supplement this equation with something like, let's say, u of x t0 equal to psi of x. And this has to be for all the x in that interval. And this is our initial condition. And after we can choose boundary conditions. For instance, we can start by using the Dirichlet boundary conditions homogeneous. So it would mean u of 0 and t equal to 0 and u of l and t equal to 0, and this has to be for all t larger than t to 0. And this was, of course, for all x belonging to that interval 0, L. Okay. So this is our problem. Okay. So what we do, as I said, is to expand everything on the basis of the eigenfunctions of the time-independent differential operator. So in this specific case, this differential operator, as we have seen, and you already knew, this differential operator, its eigenfunctions satisfying these boundary conditions are the sinus functions, sinus of n pi L divided, n pi x divided by L. So the, the eigenfunctions we know at this point. And what we do is that we write our solution u of x and t by expanding on that basis. So it's a sum from 1 to infinity, but the coefficients of expansion this time will depend on time. Sinus of n pi x divided by L. Okay. So this is the expansion. Okay. Of course, we can even write, we are going to use it in a moment, how in principle can be written an projecting the solution on this. An is equal to 2 over L. This is the normalization of our sinus functions. Integral from 0 to L dx. And here we have u of x and t, sinus of n pi x over L. Of course, this depends on time. Okay. The 2 over L, as I said, is just the fact that we need to normalize the sinus function. If you have not normalized, then we have to divide by the normalization, essentially. Okay, so this is the expansion of the solution, but as I said, we have to expand everything. So we are going to expand, for instance, our function f, and also this function psi, which corresponds to the initial value of the solution. So in particular, the f of x and t will be written as a sum, again, from 1 to infinity, of coefficients, cn of t, again, sinus. And this time, yes, we know the coefficients. Notice before I wrote this because we are going to use it in a moment, but of course, we don't know u. U is what we want to determine, okay? We are just going to use this relation in a moment, but it's not, of course, usable to compute the an because we don't know u. Instead, here, of course, we know f, so it means that we can compute the cn t. Exactly as before, it is a 2 over L integral between 0 and L dx, and this time we have our function f of x and t. Sinus of n pi x over L. Okay, so what remains to be done? It is very trivial, but I will do just to be completely clear, is to expand also the left-hand side of this equation. We know already what we are going to get, but I want to check rapidly with you. I mean, what happens essentially is that if we project the left-hand side on this basis, we can at a certain moment make use of the fact that the basis corresponds to the eigenfunctions of this differential operator. And so we are going to get the eigenvalues times the eigenfunctions. while here is even more trivial because this time derivative will only affect the coefficients of the expansion of the solution. But let's do it explicitly and carefully. So let's project the differential operator on this basis. So the differential operator I'm speaking about is this object here now, this time independent differential operator, so minus k second derivative. What happens if I project on this basis? So it means that I have to compute. So there was a minus k, and I have to multiply also by 2 over L, which is the normalization. So I get minus 2k over L integral between 0 and L, integrated dx, and I have a second derivative of u respect to x squared. And I have sinus of n pi x over L. Okay. So what we are going to do now is, of course, to integrate by part. And if I integrate by part, of course, I integrate this object here first. And so what I'm getting is minus 2k over L, the u over the x sinus of n pi x over L integrated between 0 and L. And after I have to compute the derivative of this other object, the minus sign cancels, so I get a plus, and there is this 2k over L. And I have to compute the derivative, so it means that I am getting a n pi over L, and finally I get the integral between 0 and L dx of the u over dx cosinus of n pi x over L. Okay. Now, the first term is identically zero. Why is identically zero? Because, of course, this sinus function, which are the basis, satisfy the boundary conditions. So notice in this little calculation that we are performing, there is one reason to perform this calculation is the following. To notice once again that it is absolutely crucial to use a basis of eigenfunctions satisfying the same boundary conditions of the problem, because we will need to use the fact that the basis elements satisfy those conditions. So for instance, to get rid of this term here, because the sinus blah blah is equal to zero and is also equal, sorry, is equal to zero at zero and is equal to zero at L. So this is the main reason to spend 5 minutes in doing this, to notice that is absolutely crucial that the base satisfies the same boundary conditions of the problem. You recall that the function f of x in general does not respect those boundary conditions, but you recall that this is not a tragedy, because we have a convergence to the right solution, even for the convergence if the f of x is not really satisfying the same boundary conditions can be a little bit slower, but it's okay. I mean, we don't really run into any problem. The problems we would have if we were not using a basis satisfying the same boundary conditions as the solution. Okay. So now this is zero. We repeat the same trick. We perform partial integration, and we get 2k over L. N pi over L And here we get the u, and we get our cosinus of n pi x over L, again from 0 to L. And there is a minus sign because of the integration, and we will have to derive the cosinus, another minus sign. So we get a plus 2k over L. And here we get again n pi over L, and we are, it's not surprising because what we are getting here are the eigenvalues. And we have the integral between 0 and L dx of u of x sinus. Sorry, this is u of x and t in principle. Maybe it was better if I wrote everywhere this is u of x and t in principle, okay? U of x and t, just to remind. And this is again the sinus of n pi x over L. So notice that also this second integrated part is zero, but this time is zero because it is u, the solution, that is vanishing at zero and at L. So again, this is really the crucial point. The crucial point is that in order to eliminate these two terms, it is mandatory that the solution, the u, and the basis satisfies the same boundary conditions. And at this point, we are happy because what we have here, what is this integral, is what I defined a moment ago, is the projection, no? The projection of u on this basis are these coefficients a and t. So I can rewrite all this object here as, let's say, k, this quantity here, which are the eigenvalues, n pi over L square, a n of t. Okay. Nice. So now we have projected this part here. And let me project, even though it is very simple, also the first term of the equation. The time dependence, of course, is very simple because what I have to do is to write, let's say, rho c integral between 0 and L. And of course, I have a 2 over L because of the normalization integral dx. And now I have our, okay, the u over the t, and this is a sinus of n pi x over L. And what we do is to expand everything. So essentially, we can take the derivative out of this object because this doesn't depend on time. So this object here becomes rho c, and here we have a derivative respect to time, the integral between 0 and L, dx, and I forgot the 2 over L, of u of x and t, and again the sinus of n pi x over L. But this quantity here is again a n of t. So we are happy because now we have projected everything in our equation on this basis. And therefore we can write something like this. We can write that the left-hand side of the equation can be written as a sum from 1 to infinity of rho c, just what we got now, dAn over the t. And after we have the term containing the second derivative in space, which was k And after we add n pi over L squared. And all these objects here, sorry, there is an AN here, I forgot, of course. And all these objects here multiply a sinus of n pi x over L. So this is the expansion of the left-hand side of the equation on the basis that we have obtained by projecting both these terms on the elements of the basis. Okay. And this is also equal to f, which we already written is the sum from 1 to infinity of our cn of t in principle times again sinus of n pi x over L. So this means that of course this has to be satisfied for each x, and the sinus are a basis, so it means that the coefficients must satisfy an identity. It means that we have rho c derivative of a n respect to time plus k n pi over L squared a n is equal to c n. And this is our ordinary equation providing the time dependence of the coefficients. Okay. Of course, we have to supplement this with an initial condition. So you recall that the initial condition was written in terms of a function psi. U of x and t0 is equal to psi of x. So how can we use this in our set of differential equations? Notice that I said this is a differential equation, this is a set of differential equations, because n is running from 1 in principle up to infinity. Okay. So how do we use the fact that u of x and t0 we impose to be equal to psi of x? Well, we expand again everything. So the expansion of this left hand side is sum from 1 to infinity, and this of course is a n of t0 sinus of n pi x over L. And similarly we expand the psi of x, and we write as sum from 1 to infinity of components, let's call these components bn, sinus of n pi x over L, where of course also the bn can be computed. Bn is the projection, is 2 over L, the integral between 0 and L, dx, psi of x, sinus of n pi x over L. The psi of x is given, is one of the is the initial condition of our equation. So the point of course is that again this equation here has to be satisfied for each x, and so this means that a n of t0 must be equal to b n. And this provides an infinite number of initial conditions, the condition that we need in order to solve this first order equations for the time evolution. So now our problem is completely solved. Let me just remind you again. Now we are going to write an explicit solution, and we are going to discuss it, some properties of this solution. me just remind you one thing. Why we don't you always use the Fourier decomposition? You recall the problem is that the Fourier decomposition works in the simple cases in which we are able to compute the eigenfunctions. But that corresponds to a subset of the real life problems. In plenty of real life problems, for instance, the K is not a constant, okay? And so we cannot obtain analytically the eigenfunctions. And to obtain numerically is heavy as solving directly the problem, okay? That's why this technique, when it can be used, is the best. I mean, if you know the eigenfunctions, you use the Fourier decomposition. Why not? But the problem is that in general you don't. So you have to resort to some numerical technique because of that. Okay. So notice in this simple problem that we have discussed, so here everything is constant, rho is constant, c is constant, k is constant, blah, blah. We have just these two equations. So essentially, for each n, we have a first order differential equation with one initial condition. And we have solved explicitly, as you recall, at the beginning of the course, this type of problems. So this, if Cn is different from zero, Cn contains, you recall, the f. The Cn is the expansion of the f function, okay? So it's the not homogeneous term on the right hand side of the equation, okay? So if the Cn are different from zero, we can write the solution. It's just a little bit long to write, but it's simple. Let me do it for a moment, just to be complete. So the type of equation that we are dealing with is of a form, let's say, y prime plus py equal to q. Yeah. Or this depends on x. And the solution to this problem is y equal to c0, an integration constant that we fix through our initial condition, exponential of minus the integral of p dx plus exponential of minus the integral of p dx, and this multiplies the integral of q exponential of the integral of p dx again dx. Let me just remind you the structure. I mean, you recall that essentially when you solve a differential equation, you have to ask yourself if the differential equation is not homogeneous, not homogeneous. So if, for instance, q was equal to zero, no, we would have an homogeneous differential equation. Q equal to zero means that all the second term is identically zero. And of course, we just get this with one integration constant. And when we solve that not homogeneous differential equation, typically we have a special solution, a particular solution, which is this second one, that for instance we have obtained by using the technique of the variation of the constants, plus the solution of the homogeneous equation. Okay, so this is the, and in our case, of course, if we just compare what are P and what is Q, you read that P is equal to k n p over l squared 1 over rho c, while q is equal to c n again divided by rho c. Okay, I mean, just compare, you get this. So, I mean, now we can write explicitly the solution of this problem here, because we have, obtained the general solution of this problem with generic P and Q, and we just substitute. And so the solution is written in the following form: A n of t is equal to b n. Let me remind you that the b n are these objects here are the expansion of the initial value, initial condition on the basis. So essentially, they incorporate the initial value of a function at time t0. So is this bn multiplying, so as written here, so this c0 is this bn, and I have to multiply the exponential of minus p. Now notice that in our simple case, p is time independent. So we are integrating, we are differentiating in time, not in x in our case. So this is an integral in time in our case, but this is time independent. So it means that this is very simple. It's just minus k divided by rho c and pi over l square. And this is just t minus t0. The integral on time just provides us t minus t0. Plus the second term here, there is q, okay, and therefore we are getting one over rho c, and we have to write explicitly this object here. So this object is the same object as we had before, okay. And here we have a double integral, okay? So this object enters here. We just have to change the name because we integrate twice, so it will be called S, essentially, instead of T when we integrate again. And so you get the integral of the exponential, so this is an integral between T0 and T, of the exponential of minus, again, k divided by rho c. Okay, so we are evaluating this quantity here, and I have to integrate it again. And again, I have n pi over l squared, and I am integrating this in a new variable that I call s. And so what I am getting is a t minus s. The t comes from the first part, from this object here. This is still the t that I incorporated here, and the s is from the second integral, t minus s, cn of s, because this object here depends, of course, on time in principle, cn of s ds. So this is the solution. Just a little bit tricky to write, but in the last 10 minutes, after tomorrow we will do it more slowly, let me comment on one simple case. The one simple case is the case in which suppose that we have f of x equal to zero, meaning that cn is equal to zero. So what do we notice already? Well, we notice that an then is just this object. So an of t is bn exponential of minus k divided by rho c n pi over l square t minus t0. Okay, even without doing any further calculation, there is something that we can notice. Suppose that we have, recall again, the bn incorporates the initial condition. The bn, you recall, is the expansion of the psi. The psi is the value of the solution at t zero. I call it psi. I expand the psi on this basis. The coefficients of expansions are the bn. Okay. So the bn are the expansion of the initial condition. At t equal t zero, if you put t equal t zero, the coefficients are bn. So if I put the bn back there, I get exactly the psi of x. But what happens? This we will comment again a few times because it's one of the even conceptually important points of the course. What happens is that we start from, let's say, as we will show examples, but we can start from something which can be irregular. Suppose, for instance, that our psi of x, as we will see in the numerical example tomorrow, suppose that it is something like this. This is psi of x. So psi of x is something which has how we call this, a point where the first derivative is not continuous, okay, located, let's say, at L half. But, so this means, there is an important point that I think I already mentioned. When you expand a function on a basis, you recall that I already mentioned, if the function is continuous with the first and second derivative, with the first derivative continuous, then when we expand it, we get coefficients that are going to zero rapidly. They are going to zero if the function is continuous, with the first derivative is continuous, as 1 over n cube. This corresponds to a situation in which the function is continuous, with first derivative continuous. If the first derivative is discontinuous, the coefficients behave as 1 over n square. If the function is discontinuous, is 1 over n. So the more the function is irregular, the slower is the convergence of the series of the expansion. Okay, so these are the coefficients of whatever. I have a generic function. I expand on my Fourier basis, and I ask myself, how fast is the convergence? I know that in certain cases, the convergence will not be point-like, but I can ask myself if at least the convergence of the norm is fast. And the answer is, it really depends on how smooth is the function that I am expanding. Okay. So, for instance, in this case, the function has a discontinuity in the first derivative, meaning that it will be expanded in a series that will converge as, let's say, 1 over n squared. Okay. So, not very rapid convergence. But, so the bn, in this case, are the bn, which have this behavior, because the bn are the expansion of my psi of x. But what happens to the an? Notice that if I increase the value of n, the n appears in the exponential. So of course, if I put t equal to t zero, all these exponentials are equal to 1, of course. Okay. But if t is larger than t zero, even slightly larger than t zero, then I start getting exponential suppression of all the coefficients. And this exponential suppression goes as exponential of minus n squared times objects. So if you go back to the question, how fast is the convergence of the series. The BN can be very slow, but the AN will be very fast. Will be very fast because all the coefficients for time different from T0 evolves in a way which contains essentially an exponential of minus n squared. So we will see tomorrow that the evolution of this corresponds to obtaining something like this and this, etc., etc., etc. But essentially, almost immediately, we will get rid of that singular point located at L half. So we are immediately going from something which is irregular to something which is regular. And this is a typical problem, a typical situation of a problem of diffusion. We get something which is much, much smoother than the original solution, the solution at t equal to zero, the initial condition. We will see that this is connected with the fact that, for instance, we cannot really solve the inverse problem, I mean having the time evolution backward in time, because this evolution forward in time is in a sense eliminating information, because all the Fourier components which are relatively large n are immediately suppressed by the time evolution. But okay, we will come back to this a few times. Questions up to now? So I suggest just play a little with that Python thing, fix it, just change the tree into, I don't recall what is n minus one should be, okay, instead of three. And check that it works if instead of n equal to three, you put n equal to whatever, okay? I mean, I am systematically translating these codes that I had in Mathematica into Python, but as I said, me too, I am a newcomer to concerning Python, so I'm also doing mistakes. So you help me in fixing the mistakes, and probably next year I will have a clean version of the problems, but more or less they are working, okay? Okay, if you don't have questions from home, nobody from home?
No, it's all okay, thanks.
Okay, fine then, see you tomorrow. Ciao, ciao.
Arrivederci, prof.
Arrivederci.
Ciao, ciao.
Arrivederci.
Okay. Sharing. And here, how is it? Recording.